Everyone, this is Jan Kabili, and we're live with the Photoshop Show. Kerry Murphy, can you see us out there in Google Plus land?
I can see you.
Oh, that's
you're out there.
That's great. Well, welcome, everyone. I'm so glad you could be with us today. You know, there are so many reasons that we photograph. Some people do it to satisfy their creative urges. Other people do it, you know, to make money, let's be honest. people do it to keep a record of their family and watch their kids grow up, or to remember some big event in their lives. But there's one other reason to photograph, too. And that's what we're going to be talking about tonight with our special guest, Professor of Photography Roddy Macinnes. You can see him down there. Wave to the folks, Roddy.
Good evening.
And Roddy is going to talk to us tonight about one of the reasons that he photographs, which is to learn more about himself, about his own life. And he's really had a spectacular life, as we're going to see. He was born in Scotland. He has a very cute Scottish accent. And he left home when he was young, when he was a teenager. And he literally left to sail the seven seas as a merchant marine. And he lived out in the wilds of northern Canada, and he's lived in all kinds of crazy places and done all kinds of crazy things, and somehow he ended up as a tenured professor of photography at the University of Denver, where he is now. And during all that time, Roddy has a camera with him, and so that means we get to learn about his life and about how photography has influenced it. And maybe we'll learn something about how photography can influence our own lives, too. So that's what the Photoshop Show is about tonight. And before we get started with that, I would love to have Roddy and our illustrious panelists introduce themselves. So why don't we start down at the bottom? On the far left is Kerry Murphy. Kerry,
hi.
Tell us about you and where you are.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kerry Murphy, and I'm a photographer outside of the Washington, D.C. area. And I'm also a co-host on Life Through the Lens here. And most of my recent work is here on G+, but you can also find me at kerrymurphyphotography.com.
And if you guys haven't seen Life Through the Lens, it is a wonderful show. When is Life Through the Lens, Kerry?
We are on every other Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern, so next Tuesday.
And how do you watch the show? Do you go to someone's G+ stream?
You can go to any of the co-hosts. Usually it's Karen Hutton that starts it, but you can also go to my stream and watch it there.
Cool. Well, I've been there for many of the shows, and I just love it. It's always fun.
Thank you.
And next we have our special guest, Roddy Macinnes. Hi, Roddy.
Hi, Jan. Hi, everybody. And, I guess I'm going to be showing some photographs and going into a bit more depth about how I've used photography, so maybe I'll just wait for that, Jan.
Oh, that'll be cool. Well, tell us one thing, Roddy. If people want to find you online, where is the best place to find you?
Well, I mean, Flickr or Facebook. Sorry to mention Facebook today. Yeah, I mean, I have a website, but it's not very active. But you can access my Flickr page through roddymacinnes.com.
How do you spell Macinnes?
Macinnes.
That's for us Americans.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm not very organized. I've got to get the website a bit more organized.
Okay, well, we'll look forward to seeing your non-organized website and your work on Facebook, and also to what you're going to tell us tonight. But first, who is this beautiful woman right here?
What? Hi, I'm Sandra Parlow. You can find me on Google+. I'm a photographer as well, and I come from Manitoba, Canada. Which I just, from talking to Roddy, found out that he spent some time up north where I'm actually from, which is kind of cool. Mm-hmm. I am a manager for the group, the Behind the Lens Critique Group that Colby Brown runs, and I'm just really excited to be here tonight, so thank you.
Well, thank you for coming. I really appreciate it. And Sandra is going to be monitoring our chat room. So if anybody out there would like to pose some questions to Roddy or any of the panelists, go to gsnap.com/Ron Clifford, that's our co-host, and then /4296. So again, it's gsnap.com/Ron Clifford/4296, and I put that address in the invite for this Hangout that you'll find on my G+ stream, Jan Kabili. So if you can't remember that, you can just look at the invite. Also, if you want to post questions right on the G+ stream, on the where you're watching, that's fine too, and Kerry Murphy will be looking for your questions there. So, any any preliminary stuff anybody else has to say? Are we ready to go?
We're ready to go.
All set, Jan. Yeah.
Let's go.
Well, you know, if you've been watching the Photoshop show, and this is show number 11 or 12, episode 11 or 12, you know that every week we try to bring you some hard techniques as well as just enjoying our talking about photography and Photoshop. So I'm going to do that this week, and I'm going to start off by showing you something in Photoshop CS6 and Adobe Camera Raw. So I'm going to share my screen so that you can see that. Can you guys see a bunch of photos now in Adobe Bridge?
Yes,
we see that then.
Great. So here's what I want to show you tonight. First, let me try to explain it, and then I'll show you the steps of it. You know, a lot of times when we're shooting, we can't get our camera to take the full dynamic range, the full tonal range that we can see with our eye. And that's particularly true when we're shooting a scene like this where there's something really bright and then something darker. So here I was trying to shoot this building during the G+ one-year anniversary photo walk in Denver, which, by the way, was led by none other than Thomas Hawk. So how cool is that? Mm-hmm. It was really fun. And, you know, we just ran after him around Denver because that man walks really fast. I'm not kidding. I was like double-timing it after him. I could barely stop to take 6 bracketed shots of this building because I wanted to get, you know, the clouds in the sky as well as the detail in the darker building in the front. I knew I couldn't get it in one shot. And you can tell if you look at each of these first 5 shots that what I'm saying is true. The metered exposure was this one here, and it's sort of blah. And I tried bracketing by changing my shutter speed. Here I was making my shutter speed slower and getting a bit brighter, and then getting even brighter still. And here I sped my shutter speed up and made things a little darker, and then a little darker still. But none of those first 5 shots is really what I wanted to capture. So what I wanted to do is bring all 5 bracketed shots together into one merged HDR. And by HDR, I don't mean that fancy schmancy thing that you see Trey doing that is so cool looking. I just mean one merged shot that's a combination of the best tonal values from a number of bracketed shots. Make sense? High dynamic range. Extending the dynamic range that you can capture with your photographs. Okay, so I did do that. I'm going to show you how I did it, and the result was the photo that you see right here. I don't know, what do you guys think? Better than any of the component photographs?
Definitely.
Yeah, definitely, Jen.
Because, and why do you think? What's better about it?
Well, you brought up the rich tones of the building and the sky and the tall skyscraper.
That's right, and so that in this final merged photograph, I hope that you can see the detail in the windows, the detail in the clouds, and the detail in the brighter, you know, in this foreground element as well.
Hey Jan, can you click on your window to make sure that the YouTube viewers can see what you're sharing? Some of them are saying they can't see it.
Click on my window.
Like you're in the G+ Hangout, I think.
I think somebody just said that I'm on the window for some reason. I don't know why.
Which means you may have clicked on Sandra.
Oh, my God.
There we go.
Sorry.
Hey, we'd like to see you a million times. You're fabulous.
Now, right, now can you see my bridge?
People love it.
Look on your Google+ stream maybe, Kerry, and let us know.
Yeah, I'm looking.
Yeah, just waiting for somebody to say something there.
But any of you guys, if you can look on your G+ stream, then you should see what they're seeing.
Looks big to me on my screen.
Yeah, I see you. I see you, yeah.
It shouldn't see me. You should see my...
No. I see your window. Yeah. They see it as well, so we're good.
Yeah, we're good now.
Okay, that's so cool. So you guys who couldn't see it before, what I was saying is that each of these first 5 shots, which I'm highlighting here, is one of my bracketed shots. And this final one down here, the one with the blue label underneath it, is the merged result. I'm going to show you how I did it. So the way that I did it, and so by the way, whoever is typing, maybe you can mute yourself because we can hear the click click. So anyway, the way that I did it is a way I think you're really going to like, which is I used Adobe Camera Raw, the familiar to most of us sliders in Camera Raw, rather than having to use some third-party program or use the kind of elusive sliders in Merge to HDR Pro in Photoshop. So how did I get to use Adobe Camera Raw? Well, the very first step is you have to be using Photoshop CS6 and the latest version of the Adobe Camera Raw plugin for Photoshop CS6, which is plugin 7.1 of Adobe Camera Raw. And if you don't have that, as long as you have Photoshop CS6, you can go and update your Camera Raw plugin from the, I believe, from the help menu in Photoshop CS6. Then, once you've got all that going, just you start in Adobe Bridge CS6. You can see I'm in Bridge up here at the top left of my screen, which is the free program that comes with Photoshop CS6. So in Adobe Bridge, I have navigated to this folder where I've put the five bracketed shots. Let's actually get rid of my final one so we don't get mixed up. I'm just going to select that one in Bridge and say move that to trash. Okay, so now all I have are my original shots out of my camera, and I'm going to select them all by clicking on one, holding the Shift key, and clicking on the last one. All five are now selected, and I'm going to open these into Adobe Camera Raw by going up to the File menu and choosing Open in Camera Raw, or the shortcut Command or Control R. And that will launch Photoshop, and, oh, whoop, sorry, my fault, I did that incorrectly. I didn't mean to do that. Let me start again. Instead of opening in Camera Raw, my mistake, something I keep doing over and over, in Bridge, I'm going to go to the Tools menu instead, and go down to Photoshop first and open these into the Merge to HDR Pro window in Photoshop. That is step one. So Tools, Photoshop, Merge to HDR Pro. Sorry for that. You see, even the teachers make mistakes, right, Roddy?
You're forgiven, Jen. You're forgiven.
But now, you'll always remember that because you'll remember me making the mistake. Now, what's happening now is Photoshop CS6 has opened, and you can see over here in the Layers panel that Photoshop is taking each of those five photos and putting them together, each one as a layer, in a single file. And all I'm going to let Photoshop do for me is put these photos into separate layers and then align those layers one to the other. And it does that by looking at the content of the layers, and it gets everything lined up just right. And by the way, I did not use a tripod for these shots. I literally was running after Thomas, and I just kind of stopped and went, oh my God, and you know, holding my camera freehand, took these five shots. So they're not perfectly aligned, but Photoshop aligned them for me.
Nice.
And when it was done, it opened the Merge to HDR Pro dialog box that you see here. Now normally when this opens, it won't look like the way you see it here, it will look like this. This is kind of the way Merge to HDR Pro has looked always up until just a few weeks ago when we had the ability to do the technique that I've showed you here, which is when we had both Photoshop CS6 and Camera Raw 7.1. So if your Merge to HDR Pro opens and looks like this, and the mode is set to 16-bit and you see all these sliders, I suggest that you just skip over this, because the problem with this is twofold. Number one, I have an image here, a merged image, that has only 16 bits of information in it. I can work with this with many, many more times the amount of information by changing the mode to 32-bit. And the other problem with leaving it here is there's all these sliders, and you know what? I challenge anybody to describe what these sliders do. I don't think anybody knows apart from the engineers at Adobe. And so if you were going to try to use these sliders to make your HDR image, you're going to have to learn like a whole other group of sliders. And oh my God, our brains are full with what we've got anyway. So I suggest you go out of here, changing the mode to 32-bit. And this is what you see instead. You don't get all those sliders, thank God. You have only one slider, and it's a slider you shouldn't bother with, because this slider just will give you a different preview of your image. It doesn't really adjust anything about the merged image. So I just leave it the way it is. Now, I can, if I want, I'll sometimes click Remove Ghosts, because, as I said, if I'm hand-holding, maybe something has moved. Maybe I've moved, or maybe the subject matter in the photo has moved. For example, here, there were some clouds behind the building, and they probably moved over the stretch of time that I shot these five images. And they don't look too ghost-like, but if you look closely, they look a little funny where the clouds change from dark to light. So I am going to check Remove Ghosts, and then Photoshop will use one of the five images that I shot, which are represented by the five thumbnails at the bottom left, to even out those ghosts. And if I take a look over here where the clouds are dark, and notice that if I choose a different one of these five images, the clouds change a little bit. If I go and choose this image, it'll use any image I select as the basis for exactly where the clouds are going to be as it removes the ghosts. Doesn't matter which one you choose, whichever one you like. And finally, I'll click OK. Now, when I do this, Photoshop is going to create a merged file, one with ghosts removed, and it's going to open it up in Photoshop proper. So we'll just give it a minute to catch up with us to do that. Any questions so far?
I have a question.
Okay.
I was trying to do this the other day through Lightroom, actually. And when I tried to open it back up into Lightroom, it wouldn't open for me. And so I kind of questioned on my stream, and Dave Vever told me that you had to have it going back in as a TIFF.
Correct.
Rather than a PSD, or else it wouldn't open.
Absolutely correct. Okay. Now, the truth is, you can do this rather than doing what I'm going to show you in Adobe Camera Raw. You can do it in Lightroom. It's another bunch of steps, and I don't want to show both tonight. I'll show the Lightroom steps maybe next time.
Cool.
But it is true, both in this technique with Adobe Camera Raw and in Lightroom, you need to be working with a TIFF, not a PSD file. So let me show you, in using the non-Lightroom way, how I'll get my TIFF. And that is, I have here a big image open in Camera Raw that hasn't yet been saved as anything. It is simply a 32-bit merged file. So what I'm going to do is save it as a TIFF. And so I'll go to the File menu, and I'll choose Save. That will open the Save As dialog box. And I'm going to put this on my desktop. I'll put it in with the other bracketed shots. And I'll call this, I'll call this merged. How about that? I'm just calling it something different so we can recognize it. And this is the important part. I go to the Format menu in the Save As dialog, and I choose TIFF. This technique will not work with a Photoshop file, with a PSD. It has to be a TIFF, because TIFF is the only kind of non-RAW file that will retain the 32 bits and that will allow me to do the HDR stylizing inside of the Adobe Camera Raw dialog, which is the next thing we're going to do. So I'm saving this as a TIFF. I'll click Save. Now here we can see that I'm indeed saving it as a big 32-bit file, which is great. That gives me lots of headroom for the editing. So I'll click OK. Now I'm going to close this kind of floating file. This is the one that really is not a TIFF. It's a nothing. It's just the merge file from which we saved a TIFF. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So we don't need this guy anymore. We can close it just so we don't get mixed up.
Can I ask a question, Jan?
You may.
Is it necessary to take, you know, five bracketed exposures?
That's a great question, Roddy. No, bracketing depends on how contrasty the scene is. The more contrasty the scene, then the more bracketed shots I'll take. Anywhere between three shots and maybe seven shots. Some people even take more. The important point is that you bracket your shots by varying your shutter speed, not your f-stop, because you don't want the content of the image to look different. And, of course, changing the f-stop changes the depth of field.
Right.
Make sense? But 3 to 7, I would say. So I took 5. And the way I did it is I just varied the shutter speed by 1 stop. Some people will vary it by 2/3 of a stop. It depends. You have to experiment and do it the way you like. For me, it's easiest to do it manually by hand, and in that case, I know about stops. So, you know, if I started at 250, then I'll go 125 and 60, and on the other side, I'll go 500 and 1,000, and I'm done.
Would it be worthwhile maybe just using a spot meter to figure out what the exposure latitude actually is, how many stops difference there were from the highlight to the shadow?
That sounds great, but that's way too complicated for me. I know you're
That's fancy.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
You're the expert with that. So,
yeah. Oh, sorry. I'm trying to sound clever.
There you are.
Very good.
Okay, next step. So what have we done so far? We have selected the five bracketed shots. We used the Photoshop Merge to HDR Pro to create kind of big floating 32-bit file in Photoshop. We saved from Photoshop as a TIFF, and now comes the good part. I'm going back to Bridge. So I have Bridge down here in my dock. In Bridge, there in that same folder is that merged file that I just saved from Photoshop, the one I named Merged, remember?
Mm-hmm.
So I'll select that, And now I'm going to open it in Adobe Camera Raw, the mistake I made at the beginning. So now with that file selected, I'll go to the File menu, and I'll choose Open in Camera Raw.
Does it increase the file size?
Increase from what?
You know, is it the combination of all five exposures?
Yes, it is a great big huge file, big in terms of the amount of space it's taking up on your disk. So you do want to have a relatively recent computer that you're working on, and enough space to do your editing, but nothing more than you would normally have for working with RAW files.
Great.
Okay, so here I am in Adobe Camera Raw. If I move this window around, you can see it's a separate window. Adobe Camera Raw is a plugin for Photoshop. And at the top, you can see that I've got the latest of the plugins, 7.1, which is crucial. All right, now here is the beauty, or one of the beauties of this technique is, you already know how to use the sliders in Adobe Camera Raw if you have ever processed a RAW file in Photoshop or in Lightroom. Because Lightroom and Photoshop, or Adobe Camera Raw plugin for Photoshop, share these same sliders, which you see here in the Basic tab over on the right side of Camera Raw. So I don't want to go and make a big lesson about how to use these sliders. I'm just going to do this real quick. So in this case, I think I need to maybe increase the exposure a bit, which will make the midtones in the photo a bit brighter. And what I really want to do is I want to see some of the clouds in the background. So I'm going to take that highlight slider and drag that way over to the left. And that brings in a little bit of the clouds by darkening the highlights. I would like the brightest parts here to be really even whiter than they are now, to really glow. So I might take that white slider and drag that over to the right a little bit. You know, there's no right answer here. It's simply the way you want your photos to look. Now, the clarity slider always has a real great effect on the midtones. So if I were to take the clarity slider, keep your eye on the image as I drag that over to the right. And as I do, I'm trying to bring back some of the detail in the midtones, and it really makes it pop a lot more.
Yeah.
And the vibrance also can make the image pop by intensifying the color. So in this case, maybe I'll bring the vibrance slider over as well. And I think the image looks a lot better if I turn the preview on and off. That's where I started with my merged file. Here's where I am. However, there's something I don't like about it, and that is I would like the viewer's attention to go more to that old-fashioned building in the foreground, because I love the juxtaposition of the old building and the new. And it's just not bright enough. I could try maybe opening up the shadows, but that's not really doing it. So I'm not going to bother with that. Instead, I have access to all the tools in Adobe Camera Raw. Can you guys who use Camera Raw think of a way that you can adjust part of an image, making this part lighter without futzing around with the rest of the image? Anybody know, Sandra?
It's a selective adjustment tool.
Beautiful. It's actually called the adjustment brush.
She gets a gold star. I'm going to have one.
And Sandra, I'm really impressed because a lot of people don't know that there's a way both in Camera Raw and in Lightroom to deal with separate or selective parts of an image. So to do that, I'm going to go up to the toolbar at the top of Camera Raw. I'll click on the adjustment brush there. And that changes the settings over here on the right for the adjustment brush settings. Here in the settings, I'll make sure that auto mask is checked, which will help me to just make my change or my masking over the image in the front without affecting the rest of the image. And then I'll also make sure the density slider is over to the right so that all the changes I make will really affect strongly on the image. And I'm also going to set all of my settings back to their defaults by just clicking on the plus symbol next to any one of these. And now I'll come in and I'm just going to click and drag over this building. And you won't see much of a change now because I've set all my settings back to their defaults. So now I'm just going to check that I have a mask over just the building by clicking on Show Mask. And see that white mask there when I turn that on and off? So that I see I've gotten a really good mask. And the reason it was so good is because I had auto masking on. And the auto masking kind of looks for the edges of things. Now that I have only that area masked, I'll make a change like increasing my exposure. I'm going to do it a lot so you can really see the difference. I don't know, maybe I'll put it like there. So look at the difference again. That's where it was. And if I drag exposure over a lot, maybe to 1.2 in this case, I think that looks good. That foreground building is opened up without the rest of the image being affected. if I want to see more detail in the midtones of just the building, I'll go to our old friend, the Clarity Slider, and maybe I'll drag that over a whole bunch, too. Now, I'm making my adjustments pretty strong because I want to be sure you guys can see them. I might take a more subtle approach in real life, but that's what I've done here. Make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so now I'm done adjusting just the building. So I'm going to go back. I'm going to click on one of the innocuous tools, like the hand tool, to get back to my basic area where I'm not making adjustments that affect only the foreground building. So I'm kind of happy with that. If I'm not, no worries. I can always come back in here at any time and tweak this further. But for now, I'm just going to click Done. And when I click Done, that closes that Adobe Camera Raw and applies the changes to my TIFF, which you can see down here in Bridge. And I'll even make, now take a look and notice, compare the TIFF and how it looks to the five component images. I really think the TIFF looks a lot better to my eye.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
It's more saturated. I see more detail in the foreground building. I see some detail in the clouds. If I don't like it and I want to do something different, I can always open it back up, and this is the final beauty of the technique, into Adobe Camera Raw by just double-clicking that TIFF here in Bridge. Because it's kind of gotten the Adobe Raw treatment once, it knows that when I double-click, that means, oh, open you again in Adobe Camera Raw. Here it is, and maybe I want to make it even more, let's make it more wacky and vibrant, make it more like a, you know, one of those kind of, what do they call those?
Photographs?
Yeah, those really wacky HDR. You know, we could increase the saturation and the detail and the contrast to make it less lifelike and more, you know, really out there, and then click done again. And in a moment, when we go back into Bridge, we should see those changes as well. There it goes. Did you see it switch and become more saturated?
Yeah.
Okay, so those are the steps. Now, I know that's a lot of steps. So what I recommend is, if you really want to learn that, you go back to my YouTube stream, Jan Kabili 1 is my channel there, and you replay this. And just write down the steps for yourself. I'm also going to be doing this in a course I'm currently recording for lynda.com on using Photoshop and Lightroom together. And that'll be out in a couple of months. So you're probably going to want to do this sooner than a couple of months. So you can go to the YouTube stream to remind yourself. Cool?
Cool, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. So I think I've taken way more than my share of time. So I'm going to go back into Google Plus and see if I can get us back so that we can hear from our special guest, Roddy Macinnes, instead of me all the time.
Oh, geez. Now I'm getting nervous.
No, so Roddy, you're not going to do any Photoshop. You're going to show us your wonderful photos. Yeah. Talk to us about your ideas about photography and how it can help you or what the parallels are to real life.
Make sure you click on his window.
So I'm going to click on the screen share.
Please do. Thanks, Kerry.
And then desktop.
So first click screen share, Roddy.
Yeah. I did it, Jan. I'm on desktop now.
We're not seeing you. There you are.
Okay, so screen share.
Now minimize that screen by clicking the yellow button, if you would.
And then go to and minimize this one.
That'd be good.
And then minimize that one.
That one too. You got a bunch of them. There you are.
Oh, that's the wrong picture. Sorry.
There we go.
Saw something there.
How's that? Can you see that okay again?
Yeah, that's great.
So I'll just start talking about this, I guess, will I?
Please do.
Yeah. Anyway, so, I mean, I show this photograph because this is where I'm from. And I like to establish where I'm from because I think it's really important. And I would usually ask the audience where they're from.
I think but that might be where I'm from.
This is actually where I'm from. This is on a British Airways flight over to London, and I was flying down the west coast of Scotland, and you know, the little map they have in the British Airways flight was showing me exactly, you know, where I was, and that's where I'm from, right, you know, the west of Scotland. And that's the... this is not on the same aircraft, but it's a... Again, I was flying over from Canada over to Glasgow, and I looked out the window in the morning, and I saw this is the lake that I was born on. About halfway up that long lake or loch, it's called Loch Awe.
Loch.
So
nice.
Anyway, and so, you know, this is also where I'm from. This is my on the far left hand side of this photograph is my grandmother on one side of my family, and she ends up marrying this guy on the right hand side of the photograph. And And this is the other side of my family. That little baby sitting on that woman's knee is my other grandmother, and she ends up marrying this guy, you know, some years later, I guess. But and everybody seemed to be in uniform in those days for some reason. And this is my parents. That's my mother on the left, obviously, and my father on the right. And he was in the Royal Air Force during the Second World War. And my mother was in the something called the Land Army over there. And then after the war, they were working on tram cars together in the city of Glasgow. My father was the tram driver, and my mother was the conductress. And I think my mother was immigrating to Australia. And she asked my father out for a drink before she left, and they end up getting married 6 weeks later.
Wow.
and then moved up. And here's that lake. You know, that's just halfway down that lake. So they moved up to this little village up in the west of Scotland. It was a little forestry village. And I guess, you know, in Britain they cut all the trees down by you know, to build the empire, I guess, and build ships and things. And then around about 1900 they started planting trees again. And once the trees matured, they established these villages and then populated the villages, you know, with workers from the city. So that's how my parents ended up there. There's my father working in the forest. And I didn't take this photograph. This is some photojournalist took this photograph. And that's my mother. And it's also the first photograph of me because she was pregnant with me there. This is 1953. And nice metaphor with a fishing rod. And then this is me and my brother.
Wait, but Roddy, so why do you show us pictures of people who came before you?
Yeah, and I was going to get to that, Jan. You know, I'm kind of just establishing where I'm from and, you know, physically and biologically, I guess. And it's, you know, I like that about old photographs. You know, it's always about the past, of course, isn't it? But I like to kind of establish where I'm from. And I'll get to the point where I'll talk about, you know, photography creeping in, being more conscious of the camera.
Okay.
So this is me when I was a little boy. That's the village school. Yeah, so I'm just establishing some, you know, early family photographs. That I'm the kind of the tallest guy in the back row there. The back row in the extreme right is my first girlfriend.
Oh.
And then Katrina, she was the girl next door. And the girl next to her is the first girl I kissed. Apparently, she never smiled again. Apparently. And so this is 1965. This is my very first photograph. I still have the negative from this photograph. Frame number one. This is Katrina, the girl next door. You know, I took a photograph of her. My uncle had given me a camera when I was 12, I guess. And, you know, and it's kind of when you first start using a camera, you're not very conscious of the photographs you're taking or why you're taking them. So I'm kind of interested in that aspect of it. And then, you know, of course, the next photograph is of me because, you know, I take one of her, she takes one of me. Third photograph is of my father. And this is a kind of a significant photograph for me. That's my mother in the middle with two sisters. And I remember, you know, they would come up from the city for their, like, summer vacation because they had, you know, kind of miserable lives in the city. And so they would come to the country for the summer. And that's when they would take photographs. And I kind of remember thinking to myself, you know, I want to do that. I want to make a photographic record of my life. So that's when I kind of started taking photographs and becoming a bit more conscious of making this record.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the, you know, family photograph, and I think it's the British equivalent of Disneyland. Is it?
Oh, you're Stonehenge.
But, you know, when I look back at this photograph, you know, my parents are dead now, and, you know, I only have, like, two or three photographs of the family together.
Right.
You know, it's kind of, I wish there were more.
Yeah, absolutely.
I dropped out of high school when I was 15, and I went hitchhiking around Ireland, and I remember taking this photograph. This is my first self-portrait, I guess. But not a very self-conscious self-portrait. It's more of a kind of a novelty thing. You know, you see the mirror, you see yourself in the mirror, and you have the camera. And, you know, it's kind of the camera being a mirror also kind of thing is, you know, starting to be conscious of that.
Mm-hmm.
I joined the British Navy. That's me in the middle. That's probably the dumbest thing I ever did. Because I had to sign up for 12 years, but I had a chance to buy myself out after 6 months, so that's what I did.
Buy yourself out?
Yeah, you could. It was called discharge by purchase. You know, you could I think it was £20. No,
oh, my gracious.
You get it.
That's crazy.
Otherwise, I had to stay for another 11 and a half hours.
11.
So I was on this aircraft carrier. So then I get out, and I joined the Merchant Marine, which is, you know, which much more to my liking, I guess. You know, I just wanted to travel. And, you know, if you don't have much formal education, you know, you join the military or the Merchant Marine, I guess. It's kind of a classic thing to do. This is Cape Town. I spent a couple of years going back and forward to the Persian Gulf on oil tankers.
Wow.
That's me in the Persian Gulf. But it was always this idea, and I was using a Kodak Instamatic camera,
mm-hmm.
and it was this idea of, you know, keeping a record for some reason, you know, just documenting life, but not being tremendously conscious of why. Just maybe, you know, to show, you know, maybe think about the audience. The audience was probably my family back home, so I wanted to right. hear my experience with them. In fact, this is me in Athens. I spent about 8 months in the Med, and this is in Athens. And I remember, you know, I took a taxi up here, and I got the taxi driver to take my photograph. And it was the idea of, you know, nobody would believe me back home that I'd been to Athens unless I was in the photograph.
Right.
Well, you know, and it's kind of sort of evidence of my existence in Athens. And then I got a job with the Hudson's Bay Company in Canada. They at that time recruited people in Scotland, I guess, you know, because they thought Scottish people could be okay living in isolation. And this is an Indian reservation up in northern Quebec, like it was Mistassini Post. And these are the fur planes coming in at night. And my job was to, you know, unload the fur plane, load the plane back up with, you know, lard and flour and sugar and then pack all the furs. That's me packing a beaver pelt.
Oh, my goodness.
Is this familiar, Sandra?
You know, I actually have some photos in my own family album that kind of look like...
Oh, is that right? Oh,
excellent.
I packed about 8,000 beaver pelts that winter.
Wow.
But I was really an animal lover, you know, so it was kind of contrary to my ethics, I guess. So I got out of the big company and started working in minerals exploration. And it was, you know, still a big adventure. So, it's, you know, getting to see northern Canada on someone else's dime was great. So this is my first winter living in a tent in northern Quebec.
That's cool.
The guy standing to my left is the guy, Joe Shakapio, and he was teaching me how to live in a tent in the wintertime, which I never did figure out. Being a tent. I remember those cold nights, Sandra.
I don't know how you did it in the tent.
Yeah, that's pretty hardcore.
So I spent about 10 years living in tents in Canada, winter and summer, you know, and it was a great adventure. And, I would take self-portraits of myself like this just to, you know, for memory, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But still kind of not tremendously conscious of why, I guess. And this is a, you know, so every, you know, over those, well, I spent 20 years in minerals exploration, and I would document each job that I would go on. This particular job is up in, I guess I flew out of Winnipeg for this job. It's north of Churchill, Manitoba, up in the Hudson's Bay, the western part of the Hudson's Bay. And it was a gold exploration job, and that's a drill on the right there, diamond drill, you know, drilling, core drilling for gold. And that's a piece of the core. And the VG is visible gold. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of unusual to see, actually, in drill core.
Wow.
And everything up there had to be flown around by helicopter. I guess you couldn't have land vehicles on the tundra because the tire marks would be there for 100 years, I guess. I guess it was really fragile. That's lunchtime. That's me, second from the left. Lunchtime in the Hudson's Bay. And I don't consider myself a wildlife photographer, but, you know, if it bumps into you, you have to take a photograph, like everything else.
Of course. Just
a little Arctic fox that followed me around all day.
Oh, my goodness.
It's adorable.
It's a huge...
It's adorable. Oh, wow.
These are some falcons, I guess, and they were covered in mosquitoes.
That's
a lot of mosquitoes up there.
That looks a little aggravating.
Here's a dead deer.
Okay.
Probably a bear.
Oh!
Good grief, it looks like a train hit it.
Oh, man, yeah, I know. I took this photograph and then got the hell out of there. Because it looked like it just happened.
Right, like something.
I'm not sure it was a wolf or a bear, probably. Anyway, so there's me. But I used to take these photographs, you know, and still, I think, thinking of my family back home, you know, sort of romanticizing myself, you know, like, you know, your son's okay, he's on his adventure in Canada. This is me in a tent in northern Quebec, and, you know, this is kind of, I'd moved up in the world into, you know, wooden shacks instead of tents. I think I'm reading Armageddon.
Wow.
Which is a sign of things to come, actually. And that's my homemade table with a bottle of scotch. And that's, at that point, the bottle of scotch would last, I don't know, it would last a month, probably. And, you know, I'd have a little sip every night before I went to bed. And I used to read tons of books. And that's a fantasy poster on the wall there. It's a woman holding a pint of Guinness, you know, waiting for me when I get out. Anyway, I don't know, like 6 years later, 7 years later, I was drinking a bottle of scotch a day. And I'd transferred down to Denver in the States, you know, with the Canadian mining company. And then I left and went back to Scotland and decided to do a degree in photography in Edinburgh in Scotland. And it was a 3-year degree course, and it was mostly documentary photography. So I decided to do a documentary on myself before I did a documentary on someone else. So this is kind of my relationship with the alcohol documentary.
That's interesting.
And it's, you know, it's kind of different than this kind of self-portraiture now, because, you know, this is much more self-conscious. You know, I'm kind of subject and object, where here I was just kind of an object, you know. So kind of a grand shift for me psychologically, you know, using photography to kind of see myself now, or try and use photographs as mirrors in a sense, which is impossible, I guess, but, you know, can be, you know, in a kind of a therapeutic way.
Yeah.
So this is my relationship with alcohol. And now I'm not trying to flatter myself. I'm trying to, like, I really want to take an honest look at myself, which was, you know, kind of interesting. And then I went on and did a lot of documentary work, you know, black and white film. This is a documentary I did in a hospital in London, intensive care. And it was this idea of, you know, getting in somewhere, you know, you wouldn't normally be. You're there because you have a camera and you're kind of interested in what's going on. So, you know, I kind of fancied myself as being a photojournalist, but it never really worked out. And I did a little documentary down in northern Mexico, down in Chihuahua, in the Copper Canyon. I spent about a couple of weeks down there. And I'd been there maybe 5 years before, and I brought back the photographs that I'd taken before, you know, and then we photographed the people holding the photograph.
I love that.
And that was kind of nice, you know, because, you know, it kind of opened doors for me, because every morning outside my hotel room, you know, I'd come out of the hotel, you know, with my room with a kind of a hangover, and there'd be people waiting to be photographed. So it was kind of nice. You know, families would assemble outside my hotel room to be photographed, which was a kind of an honor and a privilege, I guess. It was kind of nice.
Sure.
Did they always bring guns?
Yeah.
Well, it's a toy gun. So, and documentary always ends up being portraits for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's always... I'm much more interested in portraits. I find, you know, when I look back on my photographs, you know, I don't look at the landscapes or the animals. I look at the people. And I did a lot of formal sort of portraiture. This is a furniture designer in Glasgow in Scotland. This is a guy up in Alaska. Mm-hmm. And I did tried all kinds of things with portraiture. This is a kind of a series on people who had kind of mild psychological disorders. This guy was sort of mildly schizophrenic, so we're trying to illustrate what it felt like using photographs. And this is my landlady. She was having some issues as well. I was going to open up a business, you know, like a psychotherapy and photography or something. I don't know. No, I'm joking. anyway, I finished that degree course, and I came back to the States. I got a green card and came back to the States. I got a green card in the immigration lottery. And I went back to work for the mining company, the Canadian mining company, and I started photographing the things I didn't really like about that lifestyle. Like, you know, the loneliness, the sense of being alone a lot. This is Southeast Alaska. You know, being on the road, you know, sort of not really having a social life, living in hotels. I think I was on my way to Ontario here from New Mexico to fly to Turkey to do one of my last jobs with the mining company. And this is me. Yeah, so this is the last job I did with the Minerals Exploration Company. This is in northeast Turkey, up on the Black Sea by Georgia. And I was having a bit of a crisis here, a bit of a mental breakdown. You know, I'd stopped drinking for 8 years, but I hadn't slept for 8 years. So I was in this kind of extreme area where I had a mental breakdown. But photographing children was kind of, was always felt like a safe thing to do.
Sure. That's beautiful.
And, you know, I was on the Black Sea, so I kind of ended up...
That's a brilliant way to notate where you were.
Oh,
love that.
So, you know, the Black Sea, I was kind of illustrating how I felt, you know, where I was, you know, because psychologically, in the Black Sea, I think, and physically.
Right.
So anyway, so I went back to revisit old photographs, and I kind of like this photograph of my history. It was, that's me standing beside my father naked, you know, without shame, without guilt, and, not ready for puberty, but, you know what happens, when the psychological baggage gets piled on, during puberty or just after, and then you spend the rest of your life trying to get rid of it again.
Yeah.
So yes. I went back to, I was having psychological issues. I was in depression and panic attacks. But luckily I'd gotten into CU Boulder to go to graduate school, and that's where I met Jan. Yay, Jan.
Yay,
and,
Jan.
For the 2.5 years there, I decided to, use photography to try and see myself again because I was in this midlife crisis. So this is from a little series of Polaroid photographs. I was, trying to illustrate where I was because I was heading down the toilet. So, and I think, photography is great because you can use it for everything, can't you? You can use it to illustrate where you are physically and psychologically.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the... Am I talking too fast, Jen?
No, but you better be careful about these naked photos. I don't know what's the deal.
Well, there's not that many. Not that many.
Go fast past them, okay?
Well, that one, how's that one?
Oh, no, that's safe. It's covered, man.
How about this one? This is alcohol is much easier to talk about than sexuality, isn't it? So this is me trying to illustrate what it felt like to need a drink. And that's Paxil, that's the antidepressant that kind of saved my life. I always think that Paxil and photography saved my life. Anyway, I don't know, should I talk about this stuff, Jan?
I don't know.
Okay, well, everything for me, all the baggage related back to this guy on this ship in the Mediterranean who kind of sexually abused me for a week. And it's kind of a traumatic experience, an experience that I completely buried for until I was in my 40s. But it's kind of important to me because I kind of used photography and 12 years of psychotherapy to work through it. But it kind of influenced my photography after that. And this is me, kind of falling in love with myself again.
I love that.
I was because that way you get in life, you start not liking yourself.
Yeah.
And this is the last photograph in the series, back on the road again.
Excellent.
Anyway, something else I started doing while I was at Boulder was I started taking snapshots of people, everybody that I had significant interaction with. And it was kind of interested in the, the looking glass theory, where you come to know who you are from the reaction of other people towards you. Yeah. So this idea that, when you look at other people, when you look at them, you're trying to figure out who you are from their reaction to you. So, my idea was that when you look at other people, you're actually looking at yourself. So kind of... Oh, sorry.
I know all these people, so this is really...
Jan, I have one of you here. I think I've lost it.
Oh, boy.
Sorry, Jan, I had one of you here, but I must have opened the wrong version of this slideshow. That's my friend John. He's a Scottish geologist, from Canada and the States, and we were buddies for 30 years, and I photographed him for 30 years, even up until when he got lung cancer.
Wow.
And he died shortly after this photograph was taken.
Oh, my goodness.
And that's my parents. Summing up the relationship between men and women. I always remember I was telling my father to look at the mannequin on the table, and he said, "That's a girlykin."
And your mom.
Anyway, so I photographed them, ever since I had a camera. That's them and the photograph.
Somebody always has to be butt shot taker.
Oh yeah.
You always gotta have one in the family.
You're wonderful.
This is the first photograph I took of my father, and this is the last photograph I took of my father.
Oh my goodness.
Before he died. And as my mother, you know, I don't know, maybe the day after my father's funeral, looking at the insurance forms. And then my mother would come and spend the winters with me in the States. This is her in a kind of a fancy mall in Denver.
Yeah, in my basement.
No, well, she was also in your basement, Jen, but yeah. I won't show those photographs. Anyway, when she came here, you know, I'd say in the morning, you know, what do you want to do today, Mum? And she'd say, can we go to Denny's? And then I'd say, what do you want to do next? Can we go to Target? That was the perfect American vacation. So that's her, you know, then, you know, she got ill. She went back to Scotland. And she, you know, she got a brain tumor. And this is the first photograph of my mother. First photograph of me, you know, inside my mother. And that's the last photograph I took of my mother. Oh. I kind of put those together. You know, kind of using photography to kind of get a sense or, you know, perspective on how the journey unfolds of life. And then this is a...
cry right away.
I know. Oh, that one hit me in the gut. Oh.
Sorry, guys. The mood is swinging around here, sorry. Well, anyway, this is three of my friends, you know, and this is kind of the story of life as well, kind of, you know, in a much more less dramatic way. That's some friends of mine and Jan's friends, Andrea, Mia, and Corey. And there's Andrea pregnant, and there's Andrea's baby. I wasn't the father. But he's become one of my main subjects now.
Look at that.
Little boy. So I photograph him when I can, but I don't post the photographs of him because, you know, his father gets upset.
Right. Oh, look at that red hair. Love it.
It's adorable.
That's him. I was trying to tell him the story of my life. I do wedding photography as well. I love doing wedding photography. I don't do that many now, but I love doing weddings because, you know, it's part of this, you know, chronicling people's lives, the milestones in their lives. And at every wedding, I do a self-portrait. I've got about 400 now. I've got them posted on Twitter.
I saw that on Facebook. You have an
oh my goodness.
Album of those.
I love it.
Was that, Jen? Yeah, I put a whole bunch on Facebook and Flickr. Sometimes at the end of the day, the bride decides she's married the wrong guy.
Never mind.
Anyway, so, you know, I try to do more contemplative photography, you know, fine art photography, but I'm really a snapshot photographer. This is a pinhole project out in the Oregon coast.
Wow.
And I started, you know, playing with different... This is winding the film through the camera when it's being exposed, so it's kind of a... You know, the difference between the left-hand side and the right-hand side is about, you know, I don't know, 10 seconds or something.
Wow.
And that's the wave coming in. So I'm trying to be clever, but I'm... And, I try to do some political stuff. This is a project about security and insecurity. But I find, you know, when I try to do these projects, I kind of get angry. So I do projects that kind of connect rather than disconnect. So this is a project I'm just about to complete. It was kind of based on some photographs that I found at this antiques mall about 20 years ago, I guess. And it was all photographed by women. And there was some information inside the album, the woman's name, Nina Weist, and then this SN, State Normal and Industrial School, 1917. And then she had a geographical reference in there to Jim River. So after looking at her photographs for 10 years, you know, I fell in love with her photographs because they seemed very contemporary to me. They were very, you know, it's about celebrating relationships and, you know, friendship and all that kind of stuff. So I was very attracted to the photographs. I looked at them for about 10 years. And then felt like I knew this person and where she was from. So I put the information, Jim River, and her name, 1917, into Google, and it brought me to North Dakota. And that's the woman there, Nina, her name was, and that's her holding her 1916 vintage Kodak camera.
Excellent.
And that's her, you know, with her friends. That's her on the right-hand side at the bottom, holding onto the railing. That's her there, you know. Kind of very, to me, very contemporary, you know, apart from the dress. You know, kind of photographs you would see on Facebook, you know,
right.
1917 Facebook. In fact, yeah. Anyway, she would also arrange her photographs like this, you know, and
add some
text, you know, sad but sympathetic. You know, I kind of like that, you know, it's kind
she's
of...
thoughtful, right.
Yeah, she's going to be on the surface, you know, adding other layers of meaning. So So I went up to North Dakota. You know, I made a trip up there to, I met with people of the local historical society up there, and I started working in triptychs because, and also because the landscape is kind of almost featureless. So
right, stark.
So I started to build these triptychs, you know, mimicking her photographs. This is where her family homesteaded, you know, from Finland back in the 1800s.
But those are your photos, right?
Yeah.
Sorry?
Those are your photos.
Yeah, these are my photographs. These are my photographs now, yeah. Mm-hmm. This is mine. You know, I was trying to deal with the idea of, you know, how images fade with memory and all that kind of stuff. And then I tried to do something psychological here, which was important for me. You know, the idea that this woman died, and then her daughter died, and then that was the end of her line. And then the photographs ended up in the flea market, and I picked them up, and they, you know, kind of, now I'm trying to, what I'm trying to do now is bring her into my photo album. That's the photograph in the middle is mine, and the photograph on the left and the right are hers. So now, you know, our family albums are joined, you know, so that was kind of psychologically interesting, you know, to think about photographs that way and memory.
I think it's kind of fascinating that the antique mall even sold the album, kind of back to what you were saying about you don't really know why you're documenting what you document. So,
right.
I mean, clearly this antique mall, they couldn't part with it. It means something to somebody somewhere. And
yeah, but
the
absolutely I think
right person to come in there.
Yeah, I think Nina's daughter died, and I think, you know, there was probably an estate sale or something, and, you know, somebody bought all the stuff, and it just ended up in this flea market. Yeah, which is kind of tragic, isn't it, in a sense? But anyway, that's Nina in the middle with one of her friends. She's in the right-hand side there. And she's 16 years old in 1917. So I look for common themes within my family album. That's my grandfather in 1917. And that's me in the middle of that left, the right-hand photograph when I was 16. So kind of looking for parallels. So then I started doing portraits of people, you know, local people up there. And, you know, this is a brother and sister. So I did the portraits, you know, the left and right portrait. And then I asked them to provide a photograph of them when they were 16 or 17. And then juxtapose them. And then ask the people to, you know, comment on, you know, what the photograph juxtaposed like that means to them. But it was very difficult for people to talk about it. But then some people did. This woman said, if my house caught fire, I'd run out with my photographs, but I'm not really sure why. And that kind of summed up, you know, this problem I had with photography, you know, the subconscious relationship and then the conscious relationship. You take photographs all your life, but you don't really know why. It's something, you know, it's like an extension of yourself or something. You know, it's all your memories all wrapped up in these little pieces of paper. And this woman said, I have lots of photographs, but my kids don't want them, so I just shred them. But it makes me cry when I shred them, because then the memories are gone. So, you know, I think it's 99% of it memory, I think, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. And she said, when I look in the mirror, I'm always surprised to see an old woman looking back at me. Why do photographs have to be so truthful? So this aspect of, you know, photographs tell the truth, you know, which is a complete lie, isn't it? But it's kind of a, you know, it comes the closest of any medium to representing reality the way we experienced it. So it's kind of, it's a fascinating medium, I guess, that way.
Yeah.
So I went up there and did a residency for 3 months, and I worked with 600 up in North Dakota. I worked with it's Dickey County, North Dakota, southeast North Dakota, and I worked with 650 kids. And I asked them to, you know, to go home and look at all the photographs in their house, and, you know, in, you know, the family albums, the boxes of photographs, the ones displayed in the mantelpiece, and pick one that they really like, and then they had to write about it and tell me why they liked it. And, you know, the kids loved this project, especially the younger kids. So they brought these photographs in. I photographed them holding the photograph, and then I juxtaposed it with what they wrote about the photographs. And it was, you know, kind of the full gamut of life. And I worked in this Hutterite community. There's Hutterites up in Manitoba also, I think, Sandra. Is that right?
Yes, there are many of them.
Yeah, so down in North Dakota also. And they don't believe in photography because it's the, you know, their interpretation of the Second Commandment. You know, it's kind of a false and graven image, I guess. But anyway, I managed to get in there through the school, and I noticed the girls holding a cable release in her left hand. I had them all take self-portraits in case I got in trouble.
Wow.
So, and I asked them to write, you know, what photography was. And this girl, you know, who doesn't have a camera, wrote the most profound poem about what photography. Can I read it, Jan?
Please, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so it says photograph, and it says, Her face was still within the frame, her smile frozen in place. The stillness of her silent figure was the petrified form of grace. It was almost eerie how she had no life when her eyes were bright and open, yet so far gone, none could revive her beauty, which was still there, yet unmoving and so still, until the end of time and space, till the end of memory's will. And it's, oh man, I burst into tears when I read that. You know, it's so moving. She doesn't have a camera. You know, one of my objectives was to have a conversation about what photographs mean to us. And this girl who doesn't have a camera said the most profound thing, which, mind-blowing. Wow. And then I'd ask people to bring a photograph of themselves from the. I was trying lots of different approaches to getting people to talk about, photography and memory. So bring a photograph, I would scan the photograph, enlarge the photograph, and then re-photograph them holding it where the original photograph was taken. And this is a one-room schoolhouse in North Dakota. This lady, she lived here when she graduated. This guy here, he was a bomber pilot in the Second World War. He's 92 years old. Wow. A fascinating guy. This is my friend Cheryl Lee. That's her and her father. And then, I worked with some other people. And I worked with this ladies' group that were called the Dakota Club. And I would ask them to bring an old photograph and then write a letter to the old photograph. And that seemed to really work. There was a lot of crying, when the red was better. Great. So anyway, there's Nina. She left North Dakota, and she moved to Colorado, the plains of Colorado in 1920, was a school teacher, and then moved to Pueblo, Colorado, married some guy down there, and had an insurance company, and then died in Denver in 1983. Her daughter died in 1993. That's when I picked up the photographs. And this is the only photograph of Colorado. It's Wagon Wheel Gap near Creed, Colorado. It is close to the Rio Grande River. So I went down to the mouth of the Rio Grande River, and this is a part of the project that's still ongoing. I photographed this old lady, down in the Texas-Tamaulipas-Mexico border and where the Rio Grande goes into the Gulf of Mexico. And this summer I'm going to take a photograph up at the top of the Rio Grande, maybe of a young girl, and then I'll put Nina's photograph in the middle.
I love that.
Kind of create a trip that way. Anyway, so I started a project in Israel. That's my grandfather. On the left there, he was a Scottish bagpiper in the British Army. And that's my great-grandfather on the right. He was a Russian Jewish immigrant to Scotland. And that's my grandmother sitting on his wife's knee. And there's Nina. Nina actually moved to Pueblo and married a guy who was Jewish and became Jewish. And then so I decided to go to Israel and start a project over there. This is me flying over to Tel Aviv. I want to do a project on bagpiping over there, with the Israeli and Palestinian bagpipers.
Wow. So
this is my impressions of Tel Aviv. I love Tel Aviv. It's a great city. Anyway, I met these Israeli bagpipers. So I was going to do a documentary, on them and then photograph Palestinian bagpipers, try and rise above the politics. But I spent a week on this project and I haven't actually done much more with it. But this is me in Jerusalem. I got attacked by a mob of rabbis. Anyway, and here's the next project I'm working on. I'm going to start a project on the Colorado Mineral Belt. It's a mineral belt that runs for 250 miles, through the state of Colorado, from Boulder to Ouray. And I'm going to start a project doing portraits along the Colorado Mineral Belt to revisit my minerals exploration experience days.
Wow.
Anyway, here's a lady that I photographed, several years ago, who lives at the top end of the Colorado Mineral Belt. This is one of the reasons why, where I got the idea to start this project. She does her garden's a sculptural garden. It's about the metaphysics of place and home.
Is that Deborah?
So I'm going to work with, Deborah Haynes, yes. So I'm going to work with people on the spiritual end of the who occupy the mineral belt to the miners, prospectors. Anyway, these are some of her photographs. That's a Holga photograph of her. I'll go through these fast. That's Deborah. Anyway, so typically, I've only got a few more photographs left here, Jan. I typically do snapshot photography. I just document the people in my life, post them on Facebook and Flickr. Maybe I should start posting them on Google Plus.
Yeah.
Yes, you should.
You should. Absolutely.
Yeah. So, just snapshots of friends. And Jan was on here. Sorry, Jan. I thought you were. There's some friends that just had a new baby. They're all impersonating the baby, of course. And that was it, basically. How's that, Jan? Can I go back to the screen?
Yeah, that was great, Roddy. That was great.
Excellent. Very nice.
So, you know, Roddy, I didn't want to stop you because it's so wonderful and great. But we are kind of over the hour that I wanted
to... Oh, sorry, Jan. Sorry.
No, it's...
I didn't time it. I didn't time it, Jan. Sorry.
No, you were perfect. You're right on time.
You were perfect.
I'm thinking we should maybe stop the broadcast because this is the part that will be up on YouTube. And then let's come back and talk. I have to talk to you about this stuff. There's too much.
Oh, all right.
Is that all right? Do you guys, can you come back? Carrie?
Absolutely, sure.
Yes, good. All right, bye.
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 Bye, Jen. Oh, do I switch off?
Yep, switch off and then you'll get another invitation. And other people, you can watch us as we talk about this.